Buckle your seatbelts as we launch into cyberspace for an insider's look at the secret world of Toy Story. The art of animation went to infinity and beyond with Toy Story, the world's first completely computer-generated movie. With an all-star cast of voice talent headed by Tom Hanks and Tim Allen, and a score by Grammy winner Randy Newman, the film became the number one box office champion of 1995 and won a special Academy Award.
These guys are professionals. They're the best.
Toy Story also represents an amazing breakthrough in the way movies are made. When the Walt Disney Studio joined creative forces with the computer pioneers at Pixar, they didn't just make a movie, they made history.
Draw!
Until now, feature animation meant hand-drawn cartoons, shot one frame at a time. But instead of using traditional ink and paint, Toy Story's 27 animators gave their characters life by moving three-dimensional images created inside a computer.
Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
From there, state-of-the-art computers build the geometric shapes into lifelike puppets before rendering them with color, texture, and shadows.
I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
Director John Lasseter and his computer artists and scientists spent 4 years designing everything you see. Every character, house, and car, down to each of the 1.2 million leaves on the trees in Andy's neighborhood. In fact, the more you know about how it was made, you'll never be able to watch Toy Story the same way again. It wasn't just computer magic that made Toy Story such a success. It was the heart and spirit of fun that the filmmakers put into the characters and story.
Every animator in his heart is a toy nut. Every animator is a child at heart, and I think you have to be in this medium. And so you walk around Pixar, you walk around Disney for that matter, and it's like every desk practically is filled with toys.
The best toys of all were the computer programs they invented to put high-tech graphics into the hands of cartoon animators.
I remember the moment when I first saw computer animation of any kind. I was working at Disney as an animator on Mickey's Christmas Carol. And two very close friends of mine were working on Tron. And the moment I saw it, it was like, this is it. This is the next step, the next plateau. This is the future.
Tron was the first feature film to explore computer graphics. Set inside a video game, the environments, vehicles, and special effects were all computer-generated imagery. Walt Disney Feature Animation continued utilizing computer-assisted animation to create elaborate three-dimensional architecture, like the ballroom in Beauty and the Beast. The massive stampede in The Lion King is another good example of how computer-generated models can be combined with hand-drawn characters for a spectacular effect. Back in 1990, Disney teamed with the high-tech innovators at Pixar to invent a computer-assisted production system. The CAPS process revolutionized the way animation is colored and layered. First showcased in The Rescuers Down Under, it's been used on every Disney animated feature since. Meanwhile, Lasseter and the artists at Pixar were also inventing new techniques for making character-based movies by computer. Their four experimental short films were unlike anything audiences had ever seen.
All of them focused on character animation. That was the key. You know, to me, that is the important thing to what we do, is that we create characters.
In Tin Toy, I first started developing this notion of a juxtaposition with the audience. It's where you can show them something that they are so familiar with. And then all of a sudden you make them look at it from a different point of view, looking at a cute little baby from a toy's perspective. Now from a toy, that's a monster.
Tin Toy was the first computer animated film to ever win an Oscar as the best animated short of 1989. Its success fueled their dreams of creating a full-length movie by computer.
We were inspired from Tin Toy with the ideas that we had developed in there of toys being alive, and thought there's a tremendous potential here that we could tap into. So when we came up with the idea for the buddy picture with two toys instead of two humans.
In their original idea for Toy Story, Tinny the Tin Toy is accidentally left behind at a highway rest stop. Desperate to get home, he befriends an old ventriloquist dummy. They hit the road together and find a kind of toy heaven at a preschool where they'll never get lost or outgrown. Early on, it became obvious that Tinny was too old-fashioned to be a child's favorite toy, so Tinny was out, and a brand new high-tech action figure was in.
The goal was to make Buzz the toy that any boy would just die to have.
He's probably made out of shiny steel and plastic bubbles, and he moves and flies, he gets wings, and it's a new tech toy versus one that should be discarded.
In contrast, the ventriloquist dummy began to evolve into an old-fashioned cowboy ragdoll named Woody Pride.
He's a classic piece of Americana. He's a piece of American folklore and arts and crafts. He's the old-fashioned, Western, loose-limbed, marionette without the strings.
Early character models were created and put through their paces. For a while, the undersized spaceman was called Lunar Larry, and later, Tempest from Morph. Toy Story was off and running. By June of 1992, it was time for a screen test to see if the toys would be believable on the big screen.
Hi, pal, what you doing?
I'm Tempest from Morph!
Yeah, what's his butt? Say, you weren't thinking of flying, were you?
Well...
You know, Andy loves toys that can fly.
Really?
Well then, to infinity and beyond!
You know, Andy loves toys that he can find.
These tests proved the technology would work, even though the early Woody seemed a bit mean-spirited to his rival. As for the cute little roly-poly spaceman, he needed more stature. So to bolster his appeal, they decided to open the movie with a cartoon version of the Buzz Lightyear TV show.
You will die, Buzz Lightyear!
Not today, Zurg.
As much as everyone loved the Buzz Lightyear cartoon, it wasn't the right way to start the movie. It was so impressive, how could they hope to convince an audience that the old cowboy doll could be Andy's favorite toy? So the idea was abandoned and never completed. This assembly of storyboard drawings is all that remains.
To infinity and beyond!
Don't miss the next exciting episode of Buzz Lightyear, Defender of the Universe.
Wow, Buzz Lightyear! What a cool show!
You must die, Buzz Lightyear.
Not today, Zurg!
Restructuring the story to get the right emotional beat meant going back to the drawing board, or in this case, the storyboard.
So, this is the sequence where Woody and Buzz first meet.
As with every Disney animated film, writers and storyboard artists start by creating comic book-like drawings that describe the action shot by shot.
So would you see that as more of a tilt-up or like an actual...
I think if you take
rising.
And move the camera up, then you change the perspective.
For months, the creative team kicked around different ideas to revise and improve the characters, humor, and story structure. 25,000 cartoon panels later, their final script would bring them an Oscar nomination. As the story took shape, it came time to cast the voices that would breathe personality into the toys. From the start, they had only one actor in mind for the voice of Woody.
What they did was they took a line from Turner and Hooch, which was a movie I'd made for Disney, and they actually did have a small piece of computer animation, which was Woody saying the line. And they had, boy, Woody was just in hysterics. His little fists were like pounding all over the place. He dropped down to his knees and was pounding the ground. It was kind of amazing.
Oh, no, 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 you're eating the car! Don't eat the car! Not the car!
Oh, you stupid dog!
It fit. You know, if I had come in and seen something that didn't make quite as much sense, I don't know if I'd be doing the movie, but I saw I saw Woody and he talked like I did, so it all made perfect sense.
The perfect touch for the voice of deluded space toy Buzz Lightyear was provided by Home Improvement star Tim Allen.
Toy Story is essentially, of course, a movie about a spaceman from a far-off galaxy, but he doesn't realize he's a toy. So he comes to in this little boy's world thinking that he is Buzz Lightyear.
You are a toy!
You are a sad, strange little man, and you have my pity. Farewell.
I've enjoyed it because I've always loved movie. I've always loved animated films, and I've always wondered how the voices get done. And now that I know how they're done, I will never, ever do one of these again.
No, no, no! Go, go! Just go! I'll catch up. I was actually acting in there a little bit. There's a whole bunch of you hated it though.
It's very interesting because in the beginning, Buzz Lightyear was much more superhero-like, much more Dudley Do-Right. And when we started getting Tim in for the recording sessions, he was putting a spin on it that was much more realistic. So we evolved the character, and it's much better to where he is just like a cop.
Watch yourself. Pals, who goes there?
Do you know these life forms?
Yes. They're Andy's toys.
All right, everyone, you're clear to come up.
We focused on each toy and looked at the toy, studied the toy, thought about how it was manufactured with quality of plastic, whether it was a cheap toy, whether it was an expensive toy. All these things, and combine these together to draw the personality out of it, you know? Rex.
How you doing, Rex?
He's a Tyrannosaurus Rex. The most fearsome meat-eating creature ever to walk the earth. But have you seen those pathetic arms that the toys Tyrannosaurus Rexes have? He can't even scratch his nose! So how fearsome can he be? And so for the Tyrannosaurus Rex, we got Wally Shawn to play him.
What if Andy gets another dinosaur? A mean one. I'll get replaced. I just don't think I can take that kind of rejection.
Mr. Potato Head. His facial features fall off. And that's where his personality comes from. I mean, I think you would be mad at the world if your face kept falling off all day. And so Don Rickles was a natural choice. Personally, I think it's casting of the century.
Hey, look, I'm Picasso.
I don't get it.
You uncultured swine. What are you looking at, you hockey puck?
Wait a minute. Let me find the moment.
Oh, we have a slinky dog, which is Jim Varney.
I think I got it. Wow! Golly, Bob, howdy!
Oh, shut up.
Ham sits up on the shelf and looks out the window all day, and so he's like a Mr. Know-It-All. And of course, who better to play it than John Ratzenberger from Cheers, who plays Cliff the Mailman.
This is it, Spuds. I'm sure there's not another piggy bank. I mean, what are the odds?
Yes, sir, we're next month's garage sale fodder for sure.
Andy's mother is Laurie Metcalf.
Where was the last
place
you
left the classic mother.
Well, you're just not looking hard enough.
Oh, don't worry, honey. I'm sure we'll find Woody and Buzz before we leave tomorrow.
We have a little Bo Peep ceramic lamp, and we have Annie Potts play that.
Don't let it get to you, Woody. I know Andy's excited about Buzz, but you know, he'll always have a special place for you.
I mean, I'm trying so hard to be a lamp, you know?
Feel that.
God, all those years in acting school.
It's really hard. It's much harder than I ever anticipated it would be. You have to essentially act full bore, 100%, standing there with headphones on your head.
All right. So the setup of this is you're on kind of a little podium.
Yeah.
Right. This is where
I'm totally in the hands of the directors and the writers on this thing. I'm completely given over to their impetus is what they need.
All right. Listen. No one's getting replaced.
Now they do every line probably 17 times.
What? No, listen, no one's getting replaced. This is Andy we're talking about.
All those 17 ways different.
Listen, hey. No one's getting replaced. Hey, listen, no one's getting replaced. This is Andy we're talking about.
But the end result is you run the gamut from A to Z on whatever the emotion. Like today, I said the word no. I did a riff on just saying no. And I said no every conceivable way.
No. No.
To infinity.
Love the takeoffs, don't you?
And
Beyond!
With the voices recorded, the editor puts together a version of the movie using only story sketches. From here on, the computer process differs from the way animation has been made for the last century. No more drawing, tracing, or painting. Instead, computer animators manipulate quickly rendered polygons, then send each frame through the incredibly complex computer process of overlaying shaders of color, texture maps, and reflectivity as they're rendered one frame at a time.
Whoa!
But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Every setting, toy, and prop starts out as a hand-drawn design created by art director Ralph Eggleston and the art department. The colors and mood of the scenes were defined in the pastel drawings and concept paintings many years before they ever came to life on the big screen. The approved designs are assembled into model packs that serve as a blueprint for the technical directors who construct objects inside the computer. Then, computer art leaves traditional hand-drawn animation in the dust as the almost 2,000 computer-generated models used in the film are built from scratch using wireframe geometry completely within virtual reality.
My ship! Blast! This will take weeks to repair.
Buzz Lightyear mission.
To get believable organic curves and human shapes like those in Buzz's face, actual three-dimensional clay statues were sculpted and then scanned into the computer. This handheld 3D digitizer translates the object into data the computer can interpret by connecting the surface dots. Once the shape of the model is mapped into the computer, it can be viewed from every perspective. Layout artists are the cinematographers of animation. They arrange the models into position and choose interesting camera angles to heighten the drama and action. The stagings can be moved and manipulated beyond what real cameras can do, taking us right through the ceiling if need be. Sometimes it's fun to borrow a classic shot, like in this homage to the rolling boulder scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Buzz! Buzz!
One of the things that makes Toy Story so unique is the collaboration between traditionally trained artists and animators and these amazing computer geniuses.
Together, they developed some of the most complex moving shapes ever generated by computers. Yet sometimes you could find them consulting motion studies made 100 years ago. The points of this grid, called articulated variables, or AVARs for short, are used by animators to make Scud run in a reusable cycle. Supervising animator Pete Doctor helped new animators trade their pencils and paint for a keyboard and mouse.
To move Woody, I just move the controls. This is his elbow. I can move his elbow up or down. The next one down is the wrist. I can move his wrist however I want him to look.
I think if you can actually make it work and read and communicate without any facial expressions, without the use of your face, then you've done a really successful job. So actually what we tried to do is get everything to read just in the acting, the pantomime, and then when you stick the face on, it'll only plus that.
Buzz, look, an alien!
Where?
The trick of good animation acting is getting the audience to believe that the toys have emotions and a mind of their own. To achieve this, supervising technical director Bill Reeves gave Woody over 700 animation controls, 212 in his face, including 58 for his mouth alone.
We were like pioneers, and it was so exciting. Every day you would go to work, and there would be like something new on the monitor, on the screen, and you're like, wow, that's great!
All right, men, let's move!
Move, 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 move!
One of the great moments in Toy Story is the Green Army Man scene. Everybody knows these toys. There's a few, you know, basic characteristics that we had to have. One, gun barrels always bent. Two, they have the mold flashing, the bits of extra plastic around their head. Three, their feet are attached to the base. So if, when we were putting Green Army Men in our film, we had to have those three things.
In order to capture realistic movement for the Green Army Men, the animation staff took turns hobbling around the office with their shoes nailed to a board. Believe it or not, they got paid for doing this.
While all this is going on, Ralph Eggleston and his amazing staff designed all the sets in the film. I mean, we're talking about the neighborhood, the street, the trees, the leaves on the trees, the houses. One of our favorite settings in the film was Sid's room. He's a bad kid of the film. He's sort of like a Dr. Frankenstein of the toy world.
The human characters provided animators with some of their greatest challenges. Computer scientists figured out how to give skin an oily texture and how to layer 15,000 individual hairs. Piecing Sid together meant balancing reality and caricature in a way that would do justice to the first all-computer animated screen villain.
We all agreed that Sid was the kind of kid who would grow up to be an animator.
Oh, great idea. I burned her head the other day with a magnifying
Did
glass.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Tried to burn her leg.
Details such as the burn mark on Woody's head were created with shaders, literally an overlay of texture which the computer wraps onto existing animation. Other examples of these shaders include the scratches which cover Sid's desk, the shiny aluminum surface of the air duct, and the rough graininess of the asphalt of the street. In fact, every color, texture, and pattern is a shader, right down to the reflections in Buzz's helmet and the decals on his suit. Details too time-consuming and expensive to be drawn frame by frame in cell animation. Lighting was accomplished by breaking the shot down into the various light sources, then combining them until the desired effect was achieved. Only then is a shot ready for final rendering, where a specially invented digital film printer takes over from the humans and combines the shapes, colors, and effects for each of the 110,000 frames. This is how they created the first all-digital motion picture.
It's getting on my nerves.
Are you saying you want to lodge a complaint with Star Command?
Oh, okay.
With millions of bits of data safely recorded on film, it was time to work on the soundtrack.
Oh, yeah?
With Disney animated films, they're always musicals. And the music in ours, we wanted to be slightly different.
You got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me.
Instead of the characters breaking out into song, we have the songs that are written about the emotion of the moment in the film, but it's sung by Randy Newman.
You just remember what your old past said, or you got a friend in me. Yeah, you've got a friend in me.
Grammy winner Randy Newman also wrote the score and conducted Toy Story's 97-piece orchestra on the same stage where The Wizard of Oz and Singing in the Rain were recorded.
You can't treat it as if exactly as if it were a real picture. I mean, there's stuff you have to catch, you know. You know, if something happens like that.
By the fall of 1995, the only process left was to mix the final audio. On most movies, sounds are recorded live on the set. For Toy Story, there was only silence.
They're here! Birthday guests at 3 o'clock!
Stay calm, everyone!
I didn't hear anything that time.
We've been listening to music.
Sound designer Gary Rydstrom had to create unique sound effects for each individual character. Then he expertly layered them.
Meeting adjourned.
Toy Story was set for a Thanksgiving 1995 release, and as the date neared, the volume of work exploded. What had started as a series of hand-drawn pencil sketches was evolving into a finely layered masterpiece. In the end, over 800,000 hours of machine time would be required to render the final elements for the 77 minutes of film.
Yeah, it's looking pretty good.
It's good.
When we were starting Toy Story, we knew that we would probably be making the first computer animated feature film. When it got animated, it was even more exciting. But nothing prepared us for the step that it took after it got fully rendered. My jaw was on the floor. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And I mean, I directed the movie. I knew what was coming up, and I couldn't believe how amazing it looked.
You know, Disney himself blew audiences' minds when he really took the idea of drawing cartoons and raised it to this true art form. And I think this is the next version of that. And I think that's in the grand Walt Disney tradition.
As to the future of computer animation, perhaps the toys sum it up best.
To infinity and beyond!
Everybody's going to notice and talk about the fact that this is the very first computer animated feature film. But the computers are just tools. They didn't create this picture. It's the people that created the picture.